Good morning, everyone. Let's start our worship service this morning and sing together Thy Word, number 449. Blessing to be here with each and every one this morning. Glad you're here. Welcome those who are visiting, those who are watching online. You picked a good day to come here in person. There's a potluck supper after the worship service this morning, so I hope every one of you will stay for that. We'll get to visit just a little bit and fellowship together. Before we continue with our worship service this morning, there's a couple of announcements. The first one, if you did not pick up a communion packet, would you raise your hand and make sure and let us know, and we'll make sure that Bob or someone will make and bring one to you. I got new glasses. They got both looky here and you looky yonder too, so I can see out there today, and I don't see hand one amongst anybody. Well, that's a good thing. All right, second, if you have a cellular phone, an electronic tablet, something that's going to beep or make a noise, would you take a minute right now, please, turn that off, put it in silent mode, do something with it where it's not going to be a distraction while we're worshiping our Lord and Savior this morning. I appreciate you doing that. We've got two nurseries. There's one here in the back of the auditorium and another one yonder through that door over there. If you need help finding or using any of those, just ask one of the ushers and they'll be glad to assist you with that. Last but not least, there's attendance cards in the back of the pews there. If you take time sometime this morning to fill one of those out, we'd sure appreciate having a record of your attendance. If you have prayer requests or any other needs, you can also note that on there. Feel free to drop them in the collection trays at the exit, or you can just leave them in your pews and they'll be picked up probably sometime well after we get done eating, but they will be picked up, I'll guarantee you that. Before our opening prayer, let's sing together, More Love to Thee, O Christ. A flat.
Oh. Morning, church. Let's go to God in prayer. Almighty God, Father in heaven, we come before your throne of grace and mercy this very hour, giving you thanks and praise for the loving, awesome God that you are. And Father, we just pray that you bless us this day as we have gathered to worship. Be with all aspects of worship as we hear a portion of your word, as we commune, as we give back to you, sing songs of praise. And Father, just have us completely give our undivided attention to you. Let the things of the world pass away that we may just focus on you at this time. And let our worship be holy and acceptable unto thee, Father. Father, as we have gathered together, we pray that you not only individually but collectively bless us, bless our efforts as we continue to help the borders of your kingdom here on earth grow, and let us be successful that we may see them truly grow and more lost souls come to know you, Father. And we'll give you the glory, God, for all things. Father, we just pray for our nation at this time. Pray that you continue to bless us, keep us all safe, healthy, and well. All those who are serving in any capacity, Father, just encourage us and strengthen us. And Father, as we continue on, we just pray that all we do and say will be acceptable unto you. For this we ask and pray and give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.
Give me the Bible. Of our minds for the Lord's Supper, break thou the bread of life. This next song will be on the screen only.
Christians seeking to follow the New Testament pattern gather each first day of the week to eat the Lord's Supper. They also realize that this supper is to be eaten in remembrance of Jesus' death, with a full awareness in what they are doing. Since those who eat and drink in an unworthy manner become weak and sick, and even spiritually dead, the disciple who does the opposite and partakes in a worthy manner finds in the Lord's Supper, in its communion with the body and blood of Jesus, as an opportunity to strengthen spiritually. Jesus left the glories of heaven. What kind of love was required to move one to leave a place of perfection and come to this world, especially when he knew the suffering he would suffer? For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes, he became poor, that you through his property might become rich. See him as he was exceedingly sorrowful at Gethsemane. Appreciate the agony as he prayed that the cup might pass from him, but insisted that he would carry through with the Father's will so that sinners might be saved. Imagine the pain and disappointment as Judas betrays him. The other disciples forsake him and flee, and Peter denies three times that he even knows him. Go with Jesus, he is mocked, blindfolded, spat on, and slapped. Try to feel some of the pain he experienced when the brutal scourging cut the flesh of his back. Think about the humiliation of this scarlet robe, the crown of thorns, and the reed scepter, and don't forget why he did it. See him carrying his cross to Calvary, and remember that bearing your cross for him is a reasonable request from one who literally bore his cross for you. At Calvary, the Lord was subject to shame and humiliation as his clothes were stripped from him and divided among the soldiers. Insults continued to be hurled at him, and of course he suffered that horrible, incredibly painful death on the cross. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, chastised for our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. All these thoughts are deserving of consideration during the Lord's Supper. Consider a few more mediations celebrating the victory Jesus has gained for all who accept his grace. Travel with Mary Magdalene and the other women to the tomb on Sunday morning and see their joy when they learned that he was risen. Watch Thomas' doubts disappear as he proclaims, "My Lord and my God." Walk with the apostles out of the Mount of Olives and see the risen Savior ascended into heaven to be mighty and exalted and given the name which is above all name. Allow the Lord's Supper to remind you that he is coming again to deliver his people and allow them to live with him forever. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Let's pray as we remember the giving of Christ's blood. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the love for us. We thank you, Lord, for the provision for us and the fact that the Bible shares so many things that can strengthen our lives, we might live a better life for you. As we partake of the bread, we pray that you help us to remember that sacrifice. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, we come to you again and ask that you help us as we partake of the fruit of the vine, remembering the sacrifice that you made on that cross of your blood, made it possible for us to have the hope of eternal life. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We have the opportunity to recognize the difficulties that are in the world and the way they affect our lives. And if we honestly look at that question, we find out that it turns out there's many needs out there that can make a difference in the lives of people, including ourselves, our friends, acquaintances, and the leadership of this government. And we pray, Lord, that you would be able to help us to understand the need and to give in such a way that we might do those things, of being able to accomplish those things would increase the number of people that are Christians in this world. Let's pray. Our Lord, we thank you for the blessing that we have, and at the same time we think about the opportunities we have to give. We pray, Lord, that you would help us as we give, that we might give sacrificially, and we might serve with our own time and effort. And so those things that need to be done to meet people's needs and to help them become Christians can be accomplished. We pray that those funds would be used in an effective way, and we would be part of that giving. Amen. There are plates to receive the giving at each entrance to the auditorium here, and you can also do so by providing through a text.
I love to tell the story. Before the scripture reading, we'll sing together How Shall the Young Secure Their Hearts, number 432. If it's convenient, would you stand with us while we sing this song and then remain standing for the scripture reading?
Our scripture reading today is from Psalm 119, verses 9 through 16. If you're following along in the Pew Bible, the reading is found on page 704. How can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word. With my whole heart I have sought you. Oh, let me not wander from your commandments. Your word I have hidden in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips I have declared all the judgments of your mouth. I have rejoiced in the way of your testimonies, as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts and contemplate your ways. I will delight myself in your statutes. I will not forget your word. You may be seated.
It's a beautiful day here in Sarasota and at South Trail, and we are so thankful that every one of you is present for our worship together. If you happen to be a guest today, we're glad that you've come. We hope that you will not just rush off after we're through with our worship, but that you'll allow us to get to know you and talk with you a little bit more. And as was mentioned, you've picked the right day to be at South Trail. This is a potluck, and so there is a free meal. How many of y'all like a free meal? All right. And it's good, all right? I got to sample, not in the kitchen, but at home a little bit. And so, other people, even at 10:15 last night, were sending me pictures of their dish. I mean, it's hard to go to sleep, Paul, when I'm looking at that pork loin. He's got some braided pork loin back there. So again, I know I'm not helping myself. I've already got you distracted, all right? Everybody's like, Terry, can you say amen and let's just go eat, you know? Understand, a potluck, it's a blessing. We're glad that you're here today. If you have a bulletin, open it up to the second page, and there's an outline there. And we've got a number of blanks today, a little bit of a challenge to follow along, but hopefully you can follow on the screen and on the outline, and you'll get something more out of the lesson maybe than just what I say audibly. Communication is challenging. Two men were talking, and one said, my wife is talking to herself a lot these days. The second man said, well, my wife has been talking to herself for years, and she doesn't even know it. She thinks I'm listening. Now, before you ladies get upset with me or our men, all right, understand the point of that is that communication takes effort. It is not something that happens automatically. It requires engagement. Engagement. Last week, Gwen and I were in Utah. We had the privilege of being able to see some beautiful scenery. We saw in Zion National Park and in Bryce Canyon National Park some wonderful vistas, some arches, some hoodoos. We didn't know that word until Crystal Kroll gave it to us, you know. Understand that it was beautiful. And as we looked at all that God had put on display of his handiwork, and you remember Psalm 19, the heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament, the expanse, shows his handiwork. That is God's general revelation. We got home at 5 a.m. yesterday morning, and so I'm operating on a little less than normal sleep. General revelation. God has displayed his greatness, his power, his majesty. When you look at nature and you are in awe and amazement, that is God's general revelation saying, I created it. I created it for you. I created it for you to see me. But then that's not all we have. God has given us a book. And in the Bible, God reveals more of himself, more of his will, and that is God's special revelation. It goes further. It takes us deeper. It allows to understand why we are here, why God made you, and where you are to go if you understand who God is and you have a relationship with him. This special revelation is to lead you and guide you all the way home. A beautiful, wonderful word that isn't just a place in your past. It's a place in your future. If you have this hope of what God has promised, what God has offered in Christ Jesus, you have something to look forward to. More than even the potluck, John. The potluck is good, but heaven is even more. We call the Bible a book of books. It's unique. It's a treasure house of God's word. When we say the Bible, do you realize that that's actually a very plain translation of ton biblion? In the Greek, it means the book. The Bible is not just a book, it is the book. It is the one revelation of God that is necessary for every single one of us to understand the power of God. Oftentimes, when we want to illustrate things, we use metaphors or similes. We use comparisons. If somebody is fast, we'll say he's fast as a rabbit. If somebody can't see, we'll say he's blind as a bat. I want you to notice I'm using all male images for this, all right? If somebody is a little slow, we will say he is as dumb as a rock, all right? Understand, when we say those things, we're trying to help picture or have an image of something. Well, the Bible is full of metaphoric expression or imagery as well. God is our refuge. God is our rock. God is a tower. God is also a potter, like working with the clay. God is also that good shepherd, the shepherd of our souls, leading us to where he wants us to go and nourishing and taking care of us along the way. God is pictured like that. Christ is pictured as the bread of life. He is the way, the resurrection, the life, the truth. He is the door. He is the good shepherd. We see the church pictured as the bride of Christ, a family, a body, a temple, a building. And as we all fit into that, we help bring that building to its completion. We help build it up so that it is everything and it is inhabited by God as a temple would be. Understand, all of these images are helpful. But when it comes to the Bible is not a textbook or an encyclopedia. The Bible is meant to be understood. We're told all Scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God or the woman of God can be thoroughly equipped, complete, for every good work. Now that sounds like the Bible is very useful. It's got to be understood. It doesn't take a PhD. Look around. You don't see people with necessary degrees or everything today. What you see are people who have used common sense to read the Bible and allow it to say what God meant for it to say. We can understand the Bible. We can make good use of the Bible, but it must be utilized. Are you using the Bible day in and day out? Is it your primary resource for your relationship with God? Is it what you are depending upon to be able to help you and guide you along the way? Is it your eternal GPS? God has meant to give it to you for a purpose. God's word is unchanging. In Isaiah chapter 40 and verse 8, it says, the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. It endures forever, 1 Peter 1:25. The gospel is not some passing or fleeting fancy. What God has given you in the Bible is unchanging. Mark, there was a man who visited his music teacher. And as he was visiting with the teacher, there was a woman who was singing. And the teacher looked at that student that he had years ago. He took a tuning fork and he tapped it. He said, "That's A." And he said, "That's 440 vibrations per second. And it's always 440 vibrations per second." He said, "That singer, she is sharp." The professor, the musician, could hear it. He could tell that it was off. I want you to understand, the word of God is unchanging. It is always the same, and it is meant for us to understand it so that we can live our lives in the sight of God the way He desires. It is to serve Him. It is to please Him. And I want to look today at some metaphors that are used in Scripture for the word of God. Someone has said, the vigor of our spiritual life will be in direct proportion to the place held by the Bible in our use and thought. Where do you hold the Bible in your thought and your use today? Look with me at the outline there. There are some daily benefits that are met that God has given us. And I want you to look at these. And the first one is not a direct translation. It is an interpretation or explanation. The first one is dynamite. You may say, well, I thought that was Jimmy Walker back in good times, back in the 70s. You know, dynamite. No, the word of God is dynamite. What Paul said is, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Gentile. That word for power is the Greek word dunamis. It means dynamite. Why is the word of God compared to power to dynamite? Because it is to break up and to remove all the things in our heart and in our mind that would get in the way of hearing God. We have presuppositions, we have prejudices, we have pride, and the dynamite of God's word and the power of the gospel to save is that you could not save yourself. Apart from Jesus Christ, none of us would be saved. You say, well, what about the Jews under the law of Moses? Them neither. The only way that they were saved is because it was the anticipation, the expectation that the Messiah would come and complete what was lacking in the old law. So the Jews' dependence upon salvation, Jesus. The Christians' dependence upon salvation, Jesus. The whole world that is lost depends upon Jesus Christ. The Word of God, the benefit is that it supplies us with the ability to see we need Jesus. And if you don't get that, first of all, the rest of all of these other attributes or metaphoric images, you'll miss it. Because the first thing is, you got to see yourself as in need of a Savior. And until you see that, you're going to miss everything else. Jesus said in Matthew 24, 12 and 13, because lawlessness will abound, the heart of many will grow cold, but he who endures to the end shall be saved. Our endurance is not just an exercise in perseverance. It's a matter of recognizing that Jesus is the only Savior, and I'm going to hold on to Him until the day I die. I pray that you will too. The second thing is the mirror. In James chapter 1, verses 23 to 25, for if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, He is like a man observing his face in a natural mirror, a natural way. For he observes himself, goes his way, and immediately forgets what he looked like. When we look in a mirror, it helps us to see if something needs correction or something needs help, and we do what we need to do to fix that and to correct that, to see ourselves clearly. It's for reflection and introspection. You know what the number one step for us to make a change in our lives is? A dissatisfaction. I've got to realize that something needs to change. If you haven't gotten to that point again, you've missed something. The third thing there is light. One of the benefits we get is the light. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I heard that somewhere this morning in our opening song. Are you afraid of the dark? Are you comfort? Maybe the better question is, there's no man that's going to say he's afraid of the dark. What you're going to say, Craig, is I'm not comfortable in the dark. I prefer to see where I'm going and what I'm doing. Right? Well, the light of the word of God exposes, John 3:19-21, it exposes the evil that is condemned. It opens up so that we can be able to see clearly what we are choosing, to understand the difference, that the path leads somewhere. Christians are referred to in Scripture as children of the light. We need to live of that light. A hammer. In Jeremiah 23:29, God said, "Is my word not like a fire, says the Lord, and is my word not like a hammer that breaks the rock into pieces?" Good carpenter uses a hammer in two ways, to break up or to build. Well, the word of God can break up the things that need to be eliminated, and it can help us to build up our lives into the image and the position of God. Number five, there is the sword. The word of God is living and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. We need to know ourselves, and we need to be honest with ourselves. You may know your thoughts, but do you know your intents? Sometimes we do things, and we'll even say out loud, "Why did I do that?" Sometimes I've done things where I got hurt. I said, "Why did I do that?" Well, I didn't think. I didn't think it through. I wasn't fully aware of what I was choosing. The Word of God is a sword. Have y'all ever watched one of those jugglers juggling swords? I mean, my thought about that is, this fella's crazy. Why would you do that? I mean, all it takes is one misstep. You miss the sword the way you should, and you catch it somewhere else, and guess what? You're hurt, if not dead. That sword can kill you. But let me ask you this. The mishandling of God's word. If we don't handle the sword of the Spirit, Ephesians 6:17, if we don't handle it properly, can it do damage? Yes. If I come to the Bible with my preconceptions, and I read into Scripture something that isn't there, if I don't let the Scripture speak to me, if I don't let the context and let Scripture interpret itself, all Scripture fits together, because truth cannot be contradictory. All truth fits together. The Word of God fits together. Have you ever had a doctor tell you, Dr. Thompson, you ever told somebody you need surgery? A few times, right, in your career? Did you ever have someone say, "I don't want surgery"? People can refuse. The Word of God can tell us, it can say, "Terry, you need to do some cutting. You need to let the Word of God cut and eliminate some things out of your life. It needs to allow for you to get better." But guess what we do? What we do sometimes when the Word says you need to allow God to do some cutting, we say, "Nope. No, I want to keep that. I want to hold on to that that's not right in our life." And we do that, and we refuse to let the Word of God have its effect. The Word of God is a sword. It's meant to help us. The point of all of these first group is to make us sensitive and aware of ourselves as sinners and in need of God's grace. Second group, the daily needs. That is, that God supplies things. I didn't include that the seed. The Word of God is the seed, Luke 8:11. It has that very power of life to grow. But what I did put on there is bread. Jesus said when he was tempted by Satan in Matthew 4:4, Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. As much as bread can sustain and help us and nourish us, it is powerful. In John 6, Jesus talks about the bread of life. He says, I am the bread of heaven that has come down. I'm the living bread. That bread is to help us to grow, to provide essential nourishment. Milk. And you could put there for the second one, the M, you could put milk/meat. Have you ever seen an adult that was still living on milk? 1 Peter 2:2, desire the sincere milk of it that you may grow, the milk of the word, that you may grow thereby. We got to grow. Grow up. We can't just stay where we are. We've got to mature. In Hebrews 5, 12 to 14, the Hebrew writer says, by this time you ought to be teachers, but you have need that someone teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God. You still need milk. He said, for everyone who is still using milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness. And then he goes on in verse 14 to talk about that one who is mature is able to discern between good and evil. The word of God won't leave you where you are. If you are studying it, reading it daily, the word is going to help you grow. You're not going to be stunted or immature. You're going to grow up. And believe me, if there is anything that many Christians still need to do, myself included, we need to keep growing. When we stop where we are, it doesn't help the church. It becomes an impediment to our relationships. We've got to keep growing. Don't ever become satisfied. Don't say, as I've heard so many people say at the start of my sermons, I've heard that before. And then click, they've already shut it off. And I'm like, folks, this is God's word. It isn't Terry. It's God speaking. And if we're going to grow into God's image, we've got to keep on growing. The third one there is honey, one of my personal favorites. And I will say this, just as my personal observation while we were out in Utah. Utah has some good honey. If you want honey, go to Ogden, Utah, Black Bear Diner. They've got some good biscuits and good honey, all right? I said that after John went back to prepare lunch, okay? So after we had the men's prayer breakfast yesterday, those were good biscuits too. Psalm 119, verse 103, how sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. God's word adds flavor to us. God's word doesn't leave you bland. The people who have you ever heard someone say, being a Christian is boring. Being a Christian, you can't have fun as a Christian. That person doesn't know what they're talking about. You have more fun as a Christian than you could ever have before being a Christian. Because as a Christian, we understand what really matters. There are so many things that people in the world are chasing, and you're going, what are you going to get if you get it? It's like hugging a big old thing of air. You didn't get what you thought you were going to get. And in the end, it will not give you any benefit. Honey, medicine. In Psalm 107, verse 20. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. God's word can heal. In Jeremiah 8:22, is there any balm in Gilead? We need healing. And the very power of healing comes through the word of God. It not only blesses us, but it also heals us from our wounds. Jesus came to set the captives free, to heal those who were wounded and brokenhearted. The power of the word of God gives us clarity and conviction. And then there's treasure. The word of God is a treasure. As in Psalm 19 and verse 10, there the psalmist is talking about the power of the word of God. And what he says is, more to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold, sweeter also than honey from the honeycomb. Gold and silver, treasure in this world. The kingdom of God is compared in Matthew chapter 13, verses 44 to 46, to a treasure that a man hid in the field. And the man who found that treasure was willing to go and sell all that he had to buy the land to get the treasure. Or a pearl of great price that he found. And again, he took everything he had and sold it to find or have to possess that pearl of great price. What God's word reveals gives us what is the most valuable possession in all of life. The second group, the point is to make progress toward maturing or growing in Christ. God's word has an effect. The third group, there are things that are producing or practicing boundaries to give us protection that God's word does. The first is a path. Again, your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. We have a path, a direction. Jesus talked about the broad way in Matthew 7:13-14 and the narrow way. And understanding that there are two ways. The broad way basically says, yeah, do what you please. Every man does what's right in his own eyes. Anything goes. The narrow way is to say, no, God, you know better. And I want where that path leads. I want to be able to have that possession. I've got a book in my library. I've had it since college. It says, the title of the book is, if you don't know where you're going, you'll probably end up somewhere else. I mean, I have opened the book, but the book is not the thing. I love the title. I want that book on my shelf because I want people to know if you're not living purposefully, intentionally, you're not going to end up where you will want to be. Listen, if you are not a child of God today, if you are not a Christian, ask yourself, where am I going? Do you know where you're going? Do you understand the two choices? There are two destinies and they are very different. To be in heaven with God for all eternity because he loves you and because that's where he wants you requires you to have Jesus. Jesus is the one who paid the price. Jesus is the one who will claim us. Jesus is the one who will cleanse us. Jesus is the one who will give us every spiritual blessing. Don't refuse him. Obey the gospel. Become a child of God. There's the law. And that law, again, in Psalm 19, verse 7, the law is perfect, converting the soul. It is simple, making wise the simple. The law is meant to help us. We talk about the Word of God as a law. It means that there are boundaries. I'm going to say something. I know, Craig, you're going to say this is profound. We can say yes, and we can say, what's the opposite of yes? All right, you've all heard it before, all right? Every time that I would say to my parents, can I have a candy bar? They would look at their watch and they'd say, nope, it's only an hour before dinner, lunch, dinner, whatever. And so my plan was to change all the clocks in the house before I asked for the candy bar. Kind of stack the deck in my favor. Understand the boundaries, the protection that God has given. You can't mess with the truth. To quote another, line from a movie, you can't handle the truth unless you hear it from God. And unless you place yourself in the position to say, God means what he says. I need to do what God has told me. God's word is again like a counselor. In Psalm 10 in verse 7, listen to what the psalmist describes, that what we have is what God wants us. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit. Psalm 10 and verse 7. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit and oppression. Under his tongue is trouble and iniquity. That's obviously not the verse that I was looking for. So I hope I did better in the outline. Maybe there's a better one there in the outline. Yeah, the counselor. Psalm 119 and verse 124. Verse 24. We'll find it. It's there. If you've been married, you've had to wait before. Your testimonies also are my delight. And my counselors. God's word is meant to counsel us. It's meant to help us. We all need counsel at times. We all need help at times. And so therefore, the counsel of God's word is to help us live up to our potential. And then, in Ecclesiastes 12:11, we have goads and nails. As the wise man comes to the end, and he had tried everything. He had lived to look for everything that had meaning, and he found vanity. And he said, the words of the wise are like goads, and the words of the scholars are like well-driven nails given by one shepherd. True wisdom is from God, and it cannot be ignored. We must do what God has purposed for us. Think about the Word of God. It supplies things that we need every day. It helps to benefit us and bless us so that we can fulfill and grow up in God's Word. It gives us the boundaries and protects us. Recently, there was an article in the Wall Street Journal. And because of some droughts and because of some difficulties in different places, and because of the difficulty even to have water supply with the populations increasing, there was a proposal, a company that had come out with trying to help people with a very serious problem that had come about because of the necessity of water and because of sometimes the lack of an adequate water supply. People were having trouble keeping their well-manicured, beautiful green yards. So this company came out and they said, we can help you, and for $300 or a little bit more, we can paint your yard green. Okay? Rather than having to worry about fertilizer and watering, we'll paint it and your problem is solved. It's fixed. One of the neighbors, somebody that got their yard painted green, their dog ran over there, and the neighbor complained, my dog's paws are green now. That's one way of keeping your neighbor's dog out of your yard. Painting your yard green. Think about it. That doesn't solve the problem. You don't have a yard. It's not real. It's trying to make something look like something that it's not. Folks, unless you are taking the Word of God and reading it and studying it and applying it in your life, you haven't changed anything. Transformation only comes when we let the Word of God have its way in our lives. I wouldn't encourage you to paint your yard green, and I wouldn't encourage you to use the Bible casually just to make a few little changes in your life. No. What I'm going to tell you is the Word of God is meant to transform you into the image of Jesus Christ, into the image of the person that God wants you to be. See, the Bible won't leave you where you are. It's going to show you that there's a better way, and it's going to encourage you to become what God wants you to be for God's purpose, for God's glory. What a blessing. The Word of God can change your life. Will you let it? Will you let it have its effect and its work in your life? If you've never obeyed the gospel, we encourage you today. Jesus said, he who believes and, you know, we talked about metaphors being a form of language, and is a conjunction. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved. If I want the salvation, I got to listen to what God says on the front end, on the day of Pentecost. Peter told the people there, repent, let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The power of God is in his word. Do what it says. If you've done that, but you realize in your life you've gotten off the path, let the Word of God lead you back home. Lead you back where you should be, the path you should be following. If we can encourage you in any way, the Lord calls you, it's the Lord's invitation. It's extended to you right now. If you need to come to the Lord. Just step down to the front, and we'll assist you while we stand and while we sing.
There are a few brief announcements following our prayer this morning, so if you would remain seated and after the closing prayer here. So if you would, please bow with me. We'll go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Lord God, Almighty Father in heaven, we come to you in the name of Jesus, thanking you for the privilege to do so. And as we confess our sins before you now and pray forgiveness through his name, that this prayer will be heard. Father, we are so grateful that you gave us your word through Jesus. And Father, for the power of that word to transform lives, Father. For the glory of your creation and how it so boldly proclaims your infinite creative power. Father, we're so grateful that you gave us the health and the wisdom to appreciate, to know from whom all these blessings come. Help us become more dependent on your word for guidance in our daily life. May we soften and open our hearts to permit it to do so. Grant us clear vision to see where and how we can apply it effectively along our walk, and help us to see how to use the power of your word to build and to share our faith with others. And thank you for grace and mercy in providing this spiritual nourishment in spite of ourselves, Lord. May we continue to study that you may bless our efforts to grow and mature spiritually as we thank you for the healing powers of your word, especially as it reveals our true value in this life as your precious servants, as we find our true purpose revealed through that word. Please bless our efforts to continue to permit it to continue to guide us and direct us. Please lead our nation and our leaders to seek and to find your word in their decision-making process. Father, we pray for our missionaries throughout the world and here at home, the first responders, the teachers, Lord, teachers in the public schools and the teachers here in the classrooms. We pray, Father, for all of them to see the value of your word and that they may be bold enough to reintroduce it into the classrooms. Father, we're thankful for the food we're about to receive, and we just pray you'll bless it to our good health and guide and direct us in using that good health, especially, Lord, as we go forth from here with your word into a very unfriendly world. Guide, guard, and direct us, and by all means, please surround us with your protective forces, Lord, that we can come back here again safely on Wednesday night for Bible study. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. For those of you who are visiting, we're very, very grateful that you're here. And if you haven't already taken the time to fill out a visitor card, please do so now. You can either place it in the plates on your way out or just leave it there in the pew and we'll pick it up later on. And please, if there's any way possible, stick around for our meal. There's more than enough food for everybody, and we really, really, really do want to get to know you better. So please.